Great. Well, thank you all so much for joining us for tonight's very special Zoom program. Our author, E.B. Bartels, will discuss her new book, Good Grief, on Loving Pets, Here and Hereafter, in conversation with Chloe Shaw, who's the author of What is a Dog? A Memoir. Good Grief on Loving Pets, Here and Hereafter is an unexpected, poignant, and personal account of loving and losing pets, exploring the singular bonds we have with our companion animals and how to grieve them once they've passed. Punctuated with by wry, big-hearted accounts of Bartels' own pets and their deaths, Good Grief is a cathartic companion through loving and losing our animal family. E.B. is an instructor at the Creative Writing Center, Grub Street. She's also the Wellesley Writes It editor for Wellesley Underground, and she is an on-again, off-again bookseller at Newtonville Books. In addition to writing, E.B. also works as a freelance editor, a manuscript consultant, a writing coach, a tutor, a senior editorial writer in the Communications and Public Affairs Department at Wellesley College. Her nonfiction work has appeared in many, many places, including Catapult, Electric Literature, The Believer Logger, The Rumpus, The Toast, The Butter, and the anthology The Places We've Been, Field Reports from Travelers Under 35, among others. She lives in Massachusetts with her husband, Richie, and there are many, many pets, including Terrence the Tortoise, Seymour the Dog, Bert, Dan, and Murray the Pigeons, and an assortment of fish and shrimp. And you can learn more about E.B. at her website, ebbartels.com. And Chloe Shaw lives in Connecticut with her husband, two kids, and their two dogs. What is a Dog, published last July, was her literary debut. And Kirkus Reviews calls it, says this poignant and gracefully written memoir amply embraces the complexities of the human-dog relationship in a uniquely personal way. And it's also a moving story of self-acceptance, a dog lover's warm-hearted delight. So all 60 of us or so, let's give a big virtual round of applause to E.B. and Chloe for joining us here tonight. And Chloe, you can take it away. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Robert. And thanks to the Tewksbury Library for having us tonight. And E.B., I'm honored to be here with you. I absolutely adored your book. It is such a work of heart and just brilliant research. And, you know, I can't imagine speaking to all the people you did about this topic, because I know how hard that can be. As you know, I actually lost my beloved dog Safari this summer, and we had to put him down in June. And I've been going through my own grieving process about him and my beloved father-in-law this summer. And for me, that looked like not being able to take off this hat that says dog mom all summer until now. And also not being able to wash the shirt that I was wearing when we put him down, and not knowing what to do with his ashes yet. So I just want to thank you so much for writing this book. And I guess I'd love to begin at the beginning. And how did you know to write this book, and how did it come to be?
Well, Chloe, thank you so much. It's such an honor to get to talk to you. I loved your book. Everyone here, you must read Chloe's memoir if you haven't already. And I feel like this book, it came about quite simply because I'm someone who's had a lot of pets, and pets always die in the end, unless there are some cases, and I do write about this in the book, where pets can outlive their people. One of my pets, a tortoise, Terrence, I joke that he is going to outlive all of us. So that is a possibility. But so many animals that I've loved in my life, unfortunately, they just don't live as long as people. So the origin story is I started my MFA program in creative nonfiction in fall 2012. I was at Columbia School of the Arts, and I went into it knowing what I wanted my MFA thesis to be about, which was this complex intergenerational family saga about my mom's side of the family and sort of inherited anxiety and trauma. And it was heavy to write. And when I needed a break from working on that, I would find myself drawn to writing these personal essays about pets I'd had. And I eventually brought a couple into my writing workshop, and my friends in that workshop were really, really enthusiastic about the essays and immediately started telling me about pets they had had. And all the essays ended, of course, with how those animals died and sort of what I did to remember them and how those animals sort of have lived on in my life. One of my friends, Laura, who's really smart and has a reporter background, she said sort of offhand, you know, it'd be great if maybe you threw in some research about what other people in different cultures do to mourn and remember their pets. Or she was like, didn't like the ancient Egyptians mummify animals and stuff. She's like, it would be really interesting maybe to have these essays fleshed out a little bit more with some facts. And I was like, oh, that's a cool idea. And I kind of put it away and I worked on my MFA thesis. And then in 2014, I moved from New York up to Cambridge, Massachusetts. And I was going through all my papers and I found the pet stories. And honestly, I was really sick of working on my thesis material. And I was like, I really loved writing these. And let me try out Laura's idea and do a little research. And I just fell into this black hole where I was overwhelmed learning about all these different amazing things that people currently do, but also have done for thousands of years to mourn and remember their pets. And very, very quickly, I realized this was more than just like a couple fun facts sprinkled into an essay. This could be a whole entire book. So in 2014, 2015, I started to really in earnest do research and think about how to structure and put together this book as a tribute to all the different ways that people grieve their animals.
I thought that was really, truly one of the most fascinating parts of the book for me is actually the mummification. I certainly knew about the ancient Egyptians, but I did not know that this continues today in our own country. You know, it was amazing to me to learn about that. I'm in Roscommon, Michigan right now, and I'm at a family cottage where in Roscommon, I've come here my whole life, and it's the site of the only pet cemetery I've ever known of. And you write a lot about pet cemeteries and your connection to them. And I was able to go there yesterday for the first time in, 25, 30 years, something like that. This particular cemetery is quite overrun and neglected, isn't a little bit of an understatement, but I will say when I went in there yesterday, you write about something. I don't remember which person in your book says this, but talks about how the reason they chose a cemetery is for the community. And that word really struck me when I was there yesterday, despite the disarray. It was in my childhood when we went to visit it. I remember thinking it was terrifying, you know, thanks, Stephen King, but also silly kind of, you know, there were stuffed animals and, you know, it just seemed like a little bit of a joke to me in some way. And yesterday it was just so moving, even despite the state of it, it was seeing all the names and and how long they all lived. And some had pictures on them that were all faded. A few had the dog tags or the cat tags. And I meant to mention, I'm in your honor wearing my dead pet tag necklace.
Oh, it's so good.
That my childhood friend Taya made for me. And these really are all the tags from my pets of my life. So in your honor and in theirs too. But anyway, there were dog tags, you know, around the cross on these gravestones. But I was really struck by that community feeling of it, even if no one's visiting these days or whatever, they have each other, it felt like. And I just wanted you to talk a little bit about your connection to pet cemeteries.
Yeah, well, I love pet cemeteries, and maybe it's because I never read Pet Cemetery, so I don't have that association, but I mean, so my personal connection, besides having a lot of pets and creating my own small pet cemetery in my childhood home backyard, is that I went to high school at a private school in Dedham, if anyone here is from Dedham. And that school is next door to the Animal Rescue League of Boston, has a Dedham location. And that location has one of the oldest pet cemeteries in Massachusetts, the Pine Ridge Pet Cemetery. And so when I was in high school, I was fascinated by this place. And we would go over there and we'd go for walks. And I took a lot of photography classes and we'd go over there to take like artsy pictures in black and white of the old headstones and stuff. And so I grew up kind of being aware that these places existed, and they felt very natural to me. Like, oh, of course, like they're cemeteries for people. Why wouldn't there be cemeteries for pets? And then as I was writing this book and starting to really research, there's over 700 pet cemeteries in the United States. So there's a lot of them. And there are pet cemeteries all over the globe. In the book alone, I write about, I've visited pet cemeteries all throughout America. I've also went to one outside Paris. I went to one in Tokyo. And what's really amazing to me is that regardless of the culture or the style of the pet cemetery, or where it is or how old or new it is, the love that really comes through is exactly the same to me. It feels like people, you know, are going out of their way to make this special place that doesn't have to exist, right? Legally, you don't have to bury a pet in a cemetery. You know, with a human death, there's usually like laws involving next of kin. You know, sometimes, you know, you could have the uncle that's estranged from the family and you get saddled with figuring out what their burial plans are. But with a pet, there's no law or obligation to do that. And so part of why I think pet cemeteries are honestly joyful places is because, you know, everyone's choosing to have them be there. And it's all these people choosing to have their pets who are sort of all there together. And, you know, I write about this in the introduction of my book, but I just remember witnessing in Hartsdale, New York, which has an amazing old pet cemetery. This one woman was sort of pruning the headstone, you know, cleaning up sort of the grass and the weeds around her animal's headstone. And this man came over to borrow the scissors she was using. And it was just like, they weren't like judging each other or critical of each other. They just sort of like were there together. And, you know, I like to imagine maybe chatted about their pets or shared some stories, but, it feels like a place where everyone has something in common and can kind of come together and you can find your people.
Yeah, that makes so much sense to me. And I think that brings me back to something else that I just think this book, it's such an act of love because it really gives people permission to experience grief however they experience it. And you tell so many stories about just like the one you just told without judgment, you know? I think, you also talk about this, which I have experienced a lot of too, where, you know, we all understand behaviors or, you know, whether it's taking many days off work or just not getting out of bed or when a human dies, but when a pet dies, I think there's a lot more judgment around how that might affect somebody. And the grief is real. So I just think this book is really a gift to all animal lovers in that way. Another thing that I really loved reading about in your book, also because I've experienced it in my house with my own animals, most recently when we put our dog Safari down, after we euthanized him in our yard, our vet came to us. And once he had died, we let our other dog Otter visit his body, his dead body. And we had done this once before and it proved to really give a kind of closure to the remaining dog. You know, animals really do have their own mourning process, but they also have their acknowledgement of that death. You know, they sniff around, and you mentioned this too, we were warned many different things could happen. You know, the euthanization doesn't always go smoothly, but also we were told that our dog Otter, or you know, he might get on top of him and refuse to get up. He might not care at all. He might hump him. I mean, there were lots of things that could happen. In our case, both times we've done it, it actually worked beautifully. But I have seen Otter, he's been going through his own grieving process too. He was not eating properly for a while. It's still kind of shaky. He is eating, but it's a little off. He's not as interested in the things he used to be interested in. He's coming back, but it's taken all summer, truthfully. And I just wanted you to talk a little bit about animals mourning animals.
Yeah, I am. Oh, poor Otter. That's so hard. And
it's really heartbreaking. Yeah.
Yeah. I've read a lot of different, you know, books by amazing animal behaviorists and, biologists who, you know, try really hard not to anthropomorphize, right? Like it's really hard often to not put human words and emotions and baggage onto animals. It's not fair to them, right? They don't want our garbage, but I really do think that even if Otter isn't thinking of it as grief or whatever dogs call it, animals clearly react to change. And I think that when an animal realizes that a companion of theirs is not coming back, they definitely, what looks like grieve, you know, in our eyes, and go through their own kind of way of working it out. And one of the vets who I interviewed said, you know, animals definitely understand death, and they don't have the same like words for it, but they seem to understand the concept of this creature I loved or was close to is no longer with us on this plane. So I think in terms of animals grieving other animals, what you did is, I think, really the ideal thing to be able to do. A lot of vets I spoke with actually did suggest things like, if you have other animals at home, letting them see and smell and sniff the body of the pet that is gone. So then they're not just frantically searching and wondering, yeah, you know, oh, my friend went off to the vet and never came back, right? Yeah. I always think of like Boxer in the glue factory Animal Farm.
Yes.
But so if you have the opportunity to do that, that can be really helpful to do. And with people even as well, there's the really tragic story of Hachiko, who is a famous Japanese dog who, every day he would follow his owner to and from the train station. His owner was a professor at a university, and the dog knew, because the owner was on such a ritual, like, this is the train that we walk to in the morning, and the dog would walk home, and then he knew in the afternoon what train, like he knew about the time of day, and he would always walk back to the train station to wait and then walk home with the owner. And so one day his owner had a brain aneurysm and died while he was at work, so he did not come home on the train. And so every day for, I think he lived for 9 years after the owner passed away, Hachiko would walk to the train station and wait and would walk home. And he became this sort of like local hero dog, and people in this Tokyo neighborhood started to bring him food and would give him water and scratch his ears. And actually when Hachiko died, it was this huge loss, and they made a beautiful statue actually that now is like a meeting place in Tokyo. Mm-hmm. And anyway, I mean, people love to use that story as an example of dog's loyalty, but I also think it is sort of tragic, right? Because it's like the dog didn't get closure. The dog never really knew what happened. Mm-hmm. And so there was a couple that I interviewed for my book, who told me a wonderful story about the first Yorkie they had, who, when that Yorkie died, they sat Shiva and had people come over, and they kind of follow their Jewish traditions of, you know, people sharing stories and sitting and together and remembering. And so they got a second Yorkie, and unfortunately the husband passed away in between when I first interviewed them and when I then spoke to his wife later. And his wife told me that she made a point to bring their second Yorkie to the funeral home to view his body, because her husband knew the story of Hachiko and was like, I do not want my dog to think that I've abandoned him. So if I go before my dog, like, make sure my dog knows. So I think, and you know, when you think about human grieving rituals as well, you know, there's a reason why, like, there's a wake, or there are these different rituals where you cleanse the body, wash the body, you know, dress the deceased, right? And it gives people a chance to really grapple with, like, okay, this human, this non-human is gone, right? Like, it's just a shell of who I once loved, and the person being that I love, is their essence or whatever it is elsewhere, right? That, or is not in this body anymore. So I think if you can, you know, get letting your pets have that opportunity is really valuable, though I know that's definitely not always possible. I mean, my own family, like, we've had times where we've brought, you know, we brought our dog Gwen to the vet, not really expecting that we weren't going to come home without her. That happens sometimes. So, in those cases, I think just honestly being patient with your animals, and, you know, if they're not eating or they don't feel like going for a walk, or another story that I remember one vet sharing was that someone had two elderly or two cats, and one was elderly and sick, and the owner had to wake up in the middle of the night to give the old sick cat medicine. And the younger cat got used to the owner always waking up at like 4 a.m. or whatever it was to give medicine, and the owner would give both cats treats and then they'd all go back to bed. And so when the older cat died, then the younger cat was still waking up at that time and sort of was like, oh, this is what we do, right? And so, you know, trying not to maybe change your routine too much to help your the animal that's left behind adjust. So the vet suggested, you know, keep waking up and maybe eventually you can kind of phase it out. But, like, you know, if you got used to taking a slower, shorter walking route with your dogs because one of the dogs is older, maybe stick to that route for a while, you know, as opposed to pushing the younger dog to do something different and new.
That's, yeah, the routine, I think, is so important. I know with Otter, what in our house we used to, I would feed Safari first. So I'd put his bowl down, and then Otter's in his crate. So I would bring his bowl, Otter's bowl, second to the crate and give it to him. And I don't know if this is true. Again, this is just a hypothesis, but he seems to be waiting. You know, he seemed to be waiting for the other bowl to go first. So then I started putting, I would just put water in both bowls. So I did put a bowl down so he heard it clink, but he still sits there and kind of waits like he needs permission to start eating. So we've been doing exactly what you're talking about, just being patient and not changing routine too much. I think that's right.
Yeah. And I think you don't even realize sometimes the routines you create, especially when you're taking care of an aging and sick animal. So it's really nice you're doing that for Otter.
No, it's so true. I animals adjust to our lives so much. You know, even things like, you know, if they hear, they know, you know, they know my routine of when I'm about to leave, you know, like, okay, she got her purse. Oh, she's getting her keys. And then it's just, am I going or am I staying? You know, there's always that big question. You know, I'm wondering, so, both of us, in reading your book, I mean, I just related to so much of it. I know you're not technically maybe an only child, but you sort of are, in a sense. You grew up as semi only child, and as I did, and you have a line that I love, and something about, you know, animals allowed me to be, I'm going to mess it up, maybe you remember it better, but not feel less alone. It's basically feel less alone, but, and, you know, as, so for me in my childhood, I think I relied on my animals a lot to also feel, to kind of help me express my emotions when I had trouble doing that, all kinds of big emotions. So I kind of channeled them into my dog, Agatha, for instance, who was my childhood dog. And I think, you know, children and animals, like, you know, so I have two kids, so we've had to shepherd them through both the love of their animals, but also we've lost two dogs, we've lost two cats, we've lost one tadpole, a few fish, and then we live in a rural area, so that there's all kind of wildlife that we've experienced the loss of too. I'm wondering, for you, growing up with all of these animals and losing them, as you say, over and over and over, do you think you've gotten better at that loss? Or do you think it's just really still just terrible and you just know how to manage it better?
Well, there's a story that I always think about, and I write about this and in the book as well. But when I was a freshman in college, I went home to be with my parents because we had to put down my first dog, Gus. So this was fall 2006. And Gus, I should preface as saying, was my dad's like best friend. They went fishing together in the summer. My dad got up super early every morning and he and Gus would walk together. And I mean, Gus just like loved my dad more than anybody else in the family. So anyway, my parents and I went and we're all standing there and holding him and I'm sobbing. And you know, we were there and we euthanize him and we leave the vet's office. And I remember my dad is just bawling. And I am also crying. And I turn to my dad, who's had many dogs in his life at this point, right? And I said, like, you've had to do this before. Like, I think I was sort of like mad. I was like, this is my first time euthanizing a dog. Like, I should get to be the most sad, right? And I was like, why are you so upset? And he said, every time it's horrible in its own way. And yeah. I think about that all the time, that it's just like, it doesn't get easier, right? And like, I, you know, my dog Seymour, who I have now, you know, he's almost three-ish. And so I like to think, okay, like I'll be, you know, oh, my light, one of my lights just went out. Sorry.
Yep. There you go.
And I, you know, like to think, okay, like 10 years from now, you know, maybe I'll be able to handle it better. You know, I'll be 45 and I'll be a pro at pet death by that point. And I think about my dad and him just sobbing over Gus, you know, and just, it doesn't get easier. It just, I think you figure out, if anything, the only way it gets easier is that you understand better how to help yourself and take care of yourself. I think that's maybe the feeling doesn't get less intense or less sad. If anything, actually several psychologists that I read talk about how all grief and all losses compound on every other loss basically you've experienced in your life. So people are very quick to belittle their own feelings about their pets dying. Like, oh, I shouldn't be that sad. It was just a tadpole or just a cat or whatever. And actually all those losses remind you of every other loss, right? So, you know, for example, my first loss was my pet fish that I had in middle, preschool and kindergarten. Right. And then my paternal grandfather died. And when he died in a way, right, that death reminded me of the fish dying. And then, you know, when my aunt died later, when I was in my 20s, you know, that also reminded me of my grandfather dying and of my other pets dying, you know, and all these things are just wrapped up together. And so, in some ways I think, grief gets harder as you get older because it's reminding you of more and more losses you've experienced, right? You know, because unfortunately, as you get older, that's part of life. So it definitely doesn't get easier, but I do think that you can kind of figure out better how to take care of yourself. And I think especially when it comes to pet death, not belittling your feelings, you know, treating it like real, authentic grief, which it is, right? Just because it doesn't really matter what triggers the grief is the same, right? So whether it's the death of a person you love, an animal you love, whether it's a divorce, your house burns down in a fire, like all these different amazing psychiatrists I read said all these things are basically like equal. They're all losses in different ways and they cause the same deep emotion. So, you know, I think what's important is figuring out what tools work to help you, you know, when you're grieving. And so I've learned, you know, through having pets die that for me, it's gathering photos and putting together scrapbooks or photo albums, or even just like an Instagram, you know, carousel of images or a Facebook album. And also I've learned that posting on social media is a really helpful tool for me. And I've found that's really great, because the people who think like, oh, she's just like a crazy pet lady, can just kind of scroll by it and ignore it. But the people who really want to engage and who, you know, also maybe loved the animals that I'm writing about can jump on and comment and add their own memory and maybe show me photos that I didn't know existed of my pets. And so Those are things that I have found are help me. And so I think that if anything, pet death, if it gets easier, it's not so much that the grief gets easier, but that the managing and taking care of yourself gets easier, hopefully, as you get older.
No, that's really well put. I agree with that a lot. I did find my grief over Safari to be quite overwhelming. You know, he was kind of that special kind of heart dog. For me, I felt like we were the same, but just in different forms, different beasts. But that said, I did feel that grief kind of wrapped around grief feeling. So it makes sense what you said.
And I think too, if anything, at least speaking from personal experience, is that it feels awful. But I think about all the other times in my life I've felt awful, and I think, okay, I got through it. You know, you can get moved through it, and it sucks as you go through it, but you can get out to the other side. So, but yeah, it's hard because it's all wrapped up together, right? I'm sure when you were, you know, thinking of Safari's death, you're thinking about Booker, who you write about in your memoir, and Agatha and all the other dogs you've had in your life. So.
No, definitely. Definitely. I think for me too, I feel like as I've gotten older, I've been able to be more present for it though. And I think that's helpful too. And instead of avoiding it, I used to definitely avoid those feelings a lot more. You talk about a beloved grandfather or paternal grandfather. My beloved grandfather died when I was 6 months pregnant with my son. And that was just completely utterly shattering for me. But even then, I feel like I didn't show up enough for that grief. And so I feel like it has followed me along. But, you know, you do find ways to manage it better. I definitely think that's right. And I do feel like, again, your book, I know when I wrote my book, it just opened a lot of conversations where people felt and heard and seen and known, that maybe who didn't maybe before that, as much, because it can be shameful to be so sad about an animal.
Actually, Chloe, I wanted to say, and I see several people have already shared stories in the chat, but if you have a beloved pet and a story you'd like to share, please put it in the chat. But also I started a Good Grief Instagram account. It's Good Grief Pets Book on Instagram, all one word. And I've been posting people's photos and memories of their pets. So you're welcome to submit stories and memories to me as well. For the Instagram. And I like to have that as sort of like this, it's like a virtual pet cemetery is what I'm thinking of it like. So anyway, I just wanted to jump in and make sure I said that. I'll put the info to submit the chat.
No, that's great. I think people feel so, that's exactly what I was touching on, is just feeling heard and seen and kind of known through sharing their own stories, because so many people, as you say, have pets in the world, in their homes. You know, in writing my book, it was an incredibly emotional experience for me. And it actually, you know, my book came out of an essay that I'd written a couple of years after Booker died, when I was finally ready to kind of talk about him, write about him. And writing has always been where I go to express myself best. And so when the book came along and I was writing, I know that it became a place where I was able to expand on those emotions and thoughts about both love and loss, because they always go together. And I was wondering, in your writing process, what was that like for you emotionally?
I mean, it was hard. My husband, Richie, sometimes would, you know, lovingly tease me, like, picked a really uplifting subject to be writing about in the middle of a pandemic, right? So yeah. I was we were often alone. It was just us. I was worried that like everyone I loved was going to get sick and die. And then I'm reading these really gut-wrenching, amazing, but sad memoirs about people losing dogs. And like I have all these great picture books that are like written for to help parents talk to their kids about pets dying. Like I have a whole collection of them. And it was sad and hard. And, you know, I teach a lot of essay and memoir writing classes at Grub Street. And a lot of my students often are writing about trauma or hard memories. And so we have a lot of conversations about how do you kind of take care of yourself. And a couple of different things I found, I did find having conversations with people to be really restorative. And, you know, people sharing stories with me could, you know, could be heavy, right, to hold all these memories for people. But I also found that I often got to share my own stories with people who I interviewed. That's part of why I wrote the book in the way that I did, where I weave together my personal stories in the research, is because I felt like so much of when I did interviews with people about their pets dying, it was me giving as much as they were giving to me, and it being this mutual exchange. So I found talking to people to be really helpful. And honestly, having my alive pets around was really great. Like often when things got too heavy with writing and research, like I would take Seymour out and we'd go for like a 2-hour walk, because I'd be like, I just need a break from this. Or there was this moment where I was like sitting on my computer and I was editing the, I have a whole chapter kind of where I talk about euthanasia and the really difficult parts of pet death, where you have to make the decision often regarding your pet's end of life. And I was just like sitting there crying, like looking at Microsoft Word, and I heard this squeaking in the other room. And then all of a sudden Seymour like exploded into my office, and he has this toy in his mouth and he's shaking it around, and he whips it around and it lands on the middle of my keyboard. And I just like started laughing, because it was like, he, I don't know if he sensed that I was like needed something, or he was just being like, you know, a lunatic like he is or what, but it just made me laugh. And it made me like appreciate, okay, it's really sad when our pets die, but this is the whole thing that makes it worth it, right? This is what, you know, they make us laugh, they make us smile, you know, they make us feel safe and protected. And so, you know, hanging out with my living pets and taking time to really enjoy them and love them was another way as well. And also I highly recommend, if you're working on a writing project, obviously read a lot of stuff that is, you know, similar. Like I read so many amazing writers who write about human and human animal relationships, which really helped shape my thinking and inspired me. But I also read a ton of stuff that had nothing to do with that. Like I got super into reading like Jasmine Guillory romance novels, because yes. I was just like, I need something totally different when I'm not reading like a devastating dog memoir. So. Yeah.
That's funny you say that, because our books are different in that I didn't do a ton of research. It's not, there's not a, like a journalistic bend to it. But one of the first things when I sold the book, my editor told me was, you are banned from reading any dog books, which was a welcome thing, because it was too much. Yeah. So I was doing the same thing.
And I, you know, I love like Mary Oliver Dog Songs is an incredible collection of poems, but like, man, some of those are really devastating.
Yeah.
So like, I needed to just read some stuff that was just silly and fun and joyful in a different way. Maybe didn't have any animals in it at all. So.
Yeah. No, that makes so much sense.
Yeah.
Is there one thing that, you know, so again, the mummification part of the grieving process for some people and how they memorialize their pets, was there one thing that stuck with you the most that sort of surprised you or fascinated you about how someone might grieve a pet?
Yeah, I think, I mean, honestly, at this point, I feel like I'm not surprised by anything, because I've heard so many different amazing things.
Or moved you, I should say.
Just,
yeah.
Well, so I think Well, a couple of different things. I was really interested to learn about the modern mummification that goes on. There's a group in Salt Lake City, Utah that will mummify your animal. Though to me, in a way, that wasn't that surprising because it was taking this ancient ritual and just sort of reviving it. And then taxidermy was also fascinating to interview the taxidermist because, you know, I always thought maybe it was sort of people who taxidermy animals couldn't let go of the fact that they were dead and were trying to reanimate them. But actually, it was really interesting to speak with a taxidermist about how it's actually kind of making art out of, you know, the shell of someone you loved. And it's a new sort of life form in a way, if that makes sense. And, you know, I interviewed one woman who had her Boston Terrier taxidermied, and like the way she talks about it, she's like very in touch with death, and she's a mortician, and she gets like, he's not going to come back to life. But to her, it's like having like a 3D photograph in her house, you know? So that was really moving to me. But honestly, I was really surprised by cloning because I have a rescue dog. And so part of me had that whole like rescue dog thing where I'm like, why would you pay to clone your animal when you could just go adopt one? And, you know, but I was like, you know, EB, don't be so judgmental, like talk to these people who've done this. And, you know, this one man who I interviewed, who I write about in the book, he just like loved this dog so much. And he felt that by preserving her DNA and allowing it to live on in a new life form was sort of like giving her a second chance. And she was this stray that he found. He was a police officer and this dog was brought into the police station. And so he felt like he was sort of like giving her another life in a way by you know, preserving her DNA and in new dogs. He has two actually clones from his original dog. And he just said, you know, like some people, like he's retired now. He's like, some people want to spend their retirement money on like a fancy car. And he's like, I'd rather drive like a crappy old car and have my dog kind of alive again in a way. And I was really moved by that. And I feel really strongly at this point, having done this research for as long as I have, that, you know, there's really no right or wrong way to grieve. As long as you're not hurting yourself or hurting anyone else, I think do whatever you need to do. And if that is, you know, taxiderming your dog and, you know, having them in a glass case in your living room, if it is cloning your dog, if it is having like a giant life-size oil painting made, you know, I think whatever it is, if it makes you feel better and helps you remember and love your animal, then I think it's totally fine.
Yeah, no, I love that. I think one of the greatest acts of love that this book offers is that permission to grieve as you grieve. And as you say, as long as you're not harming yourself or others, but it's really important to feel that freedom and not the shame. I just thought I'd check in with Robert to see if there are any audience questions.
Yeah, Chloe, so thanks for checking in, and we will go to the audience now. Let's see here. Teresa asks, what are some ways that we can help and support our friends and family who have lost a pet?
Well, thank you, Teresa. This is a great question. And my feeling is whatever you would do for someone who's lost a human, do the same thing. So write a sympathy card, maybe send a flower arrangement, or, you know, get somebody takeout or bring them over a home cooked meal, or even just like a gift card to go to their favorite restaurant so they don't have to worry about cooking. Or I also have found it really touching when people often gather, like I was saying, you know, you may have had a relationship with your friend's dog that they don't know about, right? Like if you always dog sat for them and you can gather photos that maybe they haven't seen before of their dog, or some sort of creating something in some way, like commissioning. If you go on Etsy and search pet memorial craft, there are so many options. And, you know, my friend's dog died and I had this great painter, paint a portrait of him and shipped it to her. And, you know, I think that there are a lot of really creative things you can do, but honestly, if you're not sure where to start, just think about like, okay, what would I do if my friend's like grandmother died? I'm going to start there and kind of do the same thing.
And if at any point, Chloe, you want to jump in, feel free.
Okay. If I could just add to that, if that's the case, I totally agree with that. And I would say start with the basics. You know, I have a friend whose daughter died, and one of the most moving and loving things she said and meaningful things for her was that someone showed up, didn't even ring the doorbell, and left on her staircase outside her door, you know, bread, milk, butter, cookies, you know, like 10 different very basic groceries, and just left it there with a note. So I agree that something that you would do for someone who just lost a person, just something basic.
Great. An anonymous attendee asks, I'm interested in your thoughts of when to get a new pet. I lost both of my senior dogs this past month, and having them part of my life for 14 years, I hate the absence of a dog and my routine with them. How do you know when is it time to get a new pet?
Well, first, I'm really sorry that you lost both of your dogs so close together. I've heard so many stories of that happening too, kind of what you were saying, Chloe, earlier with animals mourning other animals. I sometimes think if two pets are particularly synced, like an old married couple. So in terms of when to get a new pet, you know, I think it really, and this is like a terrible answer, but you know, it varies based on person, based on circumstances, based on what kind of pet. I interviewed several people who did admit to me they felt like they rushed it, that they maybe immediately went on Pet Finder and found a new dog, a puppy, like weeks after their dog passed away, and they felt like then they were sort of putting a lot of their grief onto the new animal, or always comparing the animal to the previous pet, you know, like, well, you know, Booker didn't do this ever, you know, that kind of thing, right? Or, you know, Gus would have never, you know, jumped out of the car while I was moving. And so I think, you know, giving yourself enough time, and of course that varies person by person, to kind of draw a line between like, that was this animal, this is a new friend who I'm going to love and care for. They're not the same, but I will love them in a different way. So for some people, like my parents, for example, after Gwen, who is my second childhood dog, died, she died in 2013, and my parents were like, we're not gonna have another dog, we're gonna travel the world and spend months in Florida. And then 5 years later, my mom starts sending me Pet Finder links where she's like, oh, this Cairn Terrier is up for adoption. Like, what do you think? And so for them, it was about 5 years that they really missed having a dog and decided they wanted to have a dog in their life. My husband, Richie, actually, when we first met, he had just had to put down his childhood dog, Coco, and he was hardcore, like never getting another dog, never having a dog. It's too much. I can't do that again. And I was sort of like, ooh, is this a deal breaker? I don't know. And then, you know, we kept dating, and then he kind of softened, and he was like, well, I guess, you know, you can have a dog, and maybe I'll just happen to live with this dog that you have. And then, you know, we bought our house and we started looking at dogs, and suddenly Richie's like over my shoulder as I'm scrolling through Pet Finder. And, you know, now he and Seymour are like in love with each other, and I'm like the third wheel. But I think it, you know, it varies. So for him, it was almost, I was like 8 or 9 years. And other people too, you know, often like to stagger dogs. Like Chloe, I know you do this, right? Where it's like, if you have dogs in pairs, you know, if when the older one dies, you can get a new dog, and it's sort of, then you're never without your routine. But it can be really jarring to suddenly not have anyone to go for walks with, or not have to like wake up at 6 a.m. to feed them or whatever it is. So I think just spending some time really reflecting and thinking about, not only are you ready to take on a new dog or cat or whoever it is, but also maybe thinking about like what kind and how. Like I know, like Richie, for example, didn't feel he could have another chocolate lab mix because that's what his childhood dog was. And he was like, I'd always just be comparing that dog to Coco and seeing how that dog was or wasn't Coco. So we had Seymour's a Chihuahua pit bull, totally different mix. But then like my parents only have Cairn Terriers. So, you know, it's like, it's up to you and what feels right. So I don't know, Chloe, do you have anything to add to that with when's the right time? It's just...
Yeah, no, I do think that And I know my husband's listening closely as I talk about this since we just lost one, but I have not been on Petfinder, I promise. You know, I do think it's such a personal thing. I definitely know people who've gone out literally the day after they lost their dog and got the same exact breed the next day. And I think that works for some people and not for others. It can definitely be too soon. So I think that the reflection and just, you know, just thinking through all it takes to own an animal, to be in, with a companion to an animal, and just whether your heart's ready or not.
Yeah. And I think, well, about getting the same breed, going back to pet cemeteries, I can't tell you how many times I've seen like a family plot in a pet cemetery that's like Charlie 1, Charlie 2, yeah. Charlie 3. And it's like, they're all like poodles, yeah. or, you know, whatever it is.
Yeah.
But I think something else is, I know a lot of people who have told me that they feel guilty if they go out and immediately get another dog. Because, you know, if your child dies, you know, you're not going to necessarily immediately go adopt a kid or something like that, right? You know, they feel like maybe it's not honoring the animal if you immediately replace them, right? Or makes them feel disposable in a way. Mm-hmm. And one of my favorite books to recommend, actually going back to the question about things you can do for someone grieving, I've bought this book for several people as like a gift when someone's grieving, but it's called The Last Will and Testament of an Extremely Distinguished Dog by Eugene O'Neill, mm-hmm. Who's the playwright. And he wrote this short book as a will. It's written in the style of a traditional will from the perspective of his dog who just died, Blemmy, the Dalmatian. And so Blemmy is saying, you know, I bequeath my little collar and raincoat to, you know, and he's like giving away all his possessions. But then he also says at the end, you know, the most important thing is I want you to take the love that you gave to me and give it to another dog, that, you know, another dog would be lucky to have the kind of life that I had with you all. And don't be like selfish and hoard that love. You know, you should share it with another animal. So I think if you're at all worried about, you know, I feel like I'm dishonoring the memory of my pet by getting a new one, that should be the least of your concerns, I think. But is your heart ready? Have you taken time for yourself? Maybe go on some big trip and then come back and adopt a new animal. But
yeah.
Let's see if we can squeeze one or two more questions in from the audience. Jennifer asks, do you have any suggestions for getting through feelings of guilt for the decision to euthanize? Many situations are area of gray in balancing invasive and expensive treatments versus giving a pet peace.
I have a whole chapter about this and it's not easy. I think that part of why that makes pet death, I think, especially fraught is often you have to make that call. At least in most states in the US, we don't make that call yet for other people, unless it's a very extreme circumstance. So I don't know if it's any comfort, but everyone I spoke to always felt like it was either too soon or too late. Like after the fact, they were like, I really dragged it out. I was not ready to let go. My dog was suffering. My cat was in pain and I just was trying to ignore it. Or people felt, you know, I couldn't afford that surgery. I wish I had tried chemo. I wish I had tried, you know, whatever it is. And I think, again, it varies for every person and for every animal. And I think, you know, it's hard. Like sometimes the treatment feels worse, right? Like my friend's cat, you know, they were giving her cancer treatment and it was making her miserable. And they were like, you know what, like, let's just let her have another really good summer and, you know, let her feel good. And even if she doesn't live as long, you know, they thought that was the better route. And other, you know, other folks feel like if I don't try this, I'll never be able to live with myself, to feel like I didn't try everything. So I don't know. I think have a lot of honest conversations with your vet and remember that your vet is your ally in helping take care of your pet. They are not out to get you. They just are trying to do what's best for the animal. So I think that can really help. But
I love how much you talk about vets and just such an incredible job that they do and so much responsibility. And I love the point you make, which it never really occurred to me for some reason, that they are kind of like, you know, they go from childhood to death with that animal, which is not usually what a human does with a doctor. So they're expected to know all of those specialties. I think also you mentioned this in your book, but it's also been my experience because both my last two dogs that we've had to put down, we decided to put down, they were a little murky. I mean, even the morning we put Safari down, my husband looked at me and said, this is like his best day he's had in a long time, meaning he just looked more kind of healthy or, you know, lively. And we came to the decision with both of those dogs, though, because it was clear his discomfort was greater than his comfort. And once that tipped the balance, it just, you know, I just both times came to that day where it hit me, just like took my breath away with the realization that I just wanted him to be more comfortable. And you're right. I wish we could, you know, when I was lying there with him in our yard this summer, I just had the thought, I wish we could be as good to our people as we are to our animals, because he had a beautiful death. We were lucky that way.
Yeah.
So I think we will wrap the audience questions there. I want to thank Matthew, Don, and Michelle for also asking questions, and I'm sorry we weren't able to get to them. So at this time, I'd like to give Evie and Chloe both 30 seconds each. Do either of you have any last words you want to leave with the audience?
I think I would just like, again, it's a little repetitive, but I can't help thanking you for writing this book, Evie. I can't tell you what a joy it was to read. I mean, a heavy joy at times, but I'll take that. It was very illuminating, and it felt like such good company in the world. I do confess, I couldn't bring myself to read the Gus and Gwen chapters. It felt like a little too raw. So I will get to those, but it was just it's just a beautiful book. And I think it's going to be a great resource for so many people.
Well, thank you, Chloe, and thank you, Robert, and thank you everyone for being here tonight. I just want to say thank you to everyone who has shared their stories and been so open with me. And, you know, for all the reasons we talked about, sharing your grief over an animal, people can feel very protective and a little bit embarrassed because of all the weird societal baggage we put on grieving pets. But just know your grief is valid, and find your people who will talk to you and who will get it. Like Chloe and I have had amazing conversations about losing animals. And I think finding friends who understand and who won't make fun of you and who will be there for you. And I think that's the most important thing that you can do. And you know, everyone here tonight is a potential friend who understands this. So thank you for being here.
And just to address a question that Shirley asked in the chat, Shirley, not only is EB's book available via Amazon, but it is currently the number one best-selling book on pet loss for 3 weeks running. So there you go. But in addition to Amazon, I would encourage folks to purchase a book from an independent local bookstore. And as I mentioned at the very beginning, Wellesley Books will have autographed copies of Evie's book available starting tomorrow. And I'll be sending you all an email tomorrow morning with a link to purchase a copy of that book. In addition, the email will have a feedback survey, a link to this recording, and information about some other upcoming virtual author visits. So thank you so much, EB. Thank you so much, Chloe. Thank you to Wellesley Books for being our bookstore partner. Thanks for the Friends of the Tewksbury Library and the Corning Foundation for co-sponsoring. And thank you to the 12 other libraries who helped spread the word. I hope everyone has a great rest of your night. Thank you again, EB. Thank you, Chloe.
Thank you both.
Thank you so much.
Bye, all.